Godzilla is a film about a man who can't decide whether to go to work or spend some quality time with his family.
Yeah.
I still will be here tomorrow.
Yeah.
Well, the lie detector determined that was a lie.
I'm not really sure what to make of it. I think it's a bad film, but some bits are so good they could melt your face off. So if you haven't seen the film, you can pause the video now, go watch it, and then come back and watch the rest of this video. On the other hand, if you've already seen it, or you just couldn't give a shit, continue right ahead. The plot seemed backwards, or maybe inside out, like my rectum. To break the story down into its most basic elements, the film starts with a monster attacking and destroying things. The military try to stop it, but fail. When more monsters arrive, the military decide to try and kill them all with a really big bomb. After they start the timer, the military change their mind and then have to go back in to disarm their own bomb.
How long to disarm it?
Sir, without seeing the analog mod, I couldn't even guess.
Now, I know that's an oversimplification, but it highlights two points worth mentioning. The humans have no significant effect on the overall plot, and the battle between Godzilla and the monsters is the main conflict of the story. So with that in mind, the film centres around the human characters, and it starts off strong with the guy from Malcolm in the Middle. The film does a good job at getting the audience to like the character early on.
My wife died here!
But then the focus switches over to his son, Ford Brody, who makes John Carter look well developed.
Captain John Carter, Virginia.
Anytime he interacts with someone, he comes off as a very unlikable person. Like when he interrupts these guys.
Excuse me. Hi, excuse me, I'm sorry.
Can't you see they're talking? Or when his dad gets arrested.
Your father is a good man. He needs your help right now. He's lost everything.
Yeah, so did I. But you know what? I got over it. Every time I let him in close, he always tries to drag me back, and I can't put our family through that.
Well, he is your family.
See what I mean? He has a wife and kid, but I'm not even sure why they're even in the film. They contribute nothing to the plot. Check out the Wikipedia plot summary to see how often they're mentioned.
Did anyone else find it distracting that the kid looks like a mini Brett Ratner?
There was a scene where Ford gets stuck on a train and he helps this little boy who gets separated from his parents. I just can't understand what the point of the scene was. So now Ford has a kid to look after. But then the kid just wanders off, finds his parents, and it's all just brushed under the rug. So what's the point? Potential for emotional weight or internal conflict is completely wasted. It could have been that Ford Brody is struggling with helping this kid or getting back to his own family. But they don't bother with any of that. If it was to show Ford as heroic, he could have saved anyone, without the need to go to the rescue camp and for the parents to show up and take the kid out of the plot. It was a great choice to focus on the human characters, but why focus on people that are so boring and generic? Neither Ford Brody, his wife, or his son have any sort of character arc. You know who does have an arc? This guy. He's also the most interesting and well-developed character. He's the only one with motivation to be invested in what's going on around him. The film would have been a lot stronger if they would have kept him around and cut out the generic son and family. I'd also like to have seen more of Sally Hawkins and
Unsubscribe.
They seem to know a lot about Godzilla, but it's never explained how. And I'd much rather the film focused around these characters and the story that informs them, rather than the dumb military and the bland action hero.
I'm drunk!
One of the best things in the film is Godzilla himself. They do an amazing job animating all the subtleties of a living creature. But this leads to another problem. Godzilla's barely in the film.
Well, bugger me!
In a way, I'm glad they didn't show Godzilla very much. It's better to have a small number of high-quality appearances than flooding the screen with non-stop dumb action. Some people have mentioned that Jaws didn't show the shark until the second part of the movie. So I'll use that as an example too. I wouldn't want to scare you off by doing something different. Not showing the shark until the later parts of the film worked, not because you don't see the shark, but because of the interesting interactions of the characters, the politics of the town. And this lady. You may not see the shark, but you see what the shark does, and you see the effects it has on people. It's a good way to create a build-up and a sense of rising suspense. It takes a long time for the characters to decide how to deal with the threat and then go for a ride on a boat. The story, characters and events are strong enough to carry the film without the need to show the shark. But we don't have this with Godzilla. In a way, Godzilla himself is the film's worst enemy. He's so exciting and interesting, any time he's not on screen it leaves a void that just can't be filled by the dull characters. Jaws at least shows you what's going on. You can't see the shark, but you can see the kid dying. Whenever something important happens with Godzilla, it cuts away. And that makes me sad. The film builds tension that something big is going to happen, and then just cuts away to something completely unimportant. Like this idiot. You can see some of what's happening on a TV screen in the background, but there's so much stuff getting in the way and distracting you from what's actually going on. Remember, the outcome of the fight between Godzilla and the Mutos is the most important part of the plot. I'll use the Lord of the Rings as an example to show you what I mean.
I am a servant of the Secret Fire, wielder of the Flame of Arnor. The Dark Fire will not avail you, Flame of Uldum!
What the hell are you doing?
All right, give me some forceps. I might be able to catch it in the colon.
Right on it.
Shut up. I'll get the lubricant.
There's no time for lubricant.
There's always time for lubricant.
All right, flip it.
Oh, here we go.
Prepare for your examination. Turn your head and cough. Oops. How embarrassing.
Why not just show what's going on? At one point it goes straight from build-up to aftermath. Like this.
You're the devil in disguise.
You shall not
pass! Fly, you fools!
It's like having a stroke. In fact, there's a lot of things that happen off screen. You see, he can't put up the happy birthday sign without his dad spotting him, yet it's up when they go back. How did it get up there? How did this kid get stuck on the train? How did this dog get free? How did this stationary train speed up and catch fire? Some questions can never be answered.
I'm a fire in my labor!
I could never really understand Godzilla's motivation. They say he's hunting, but he never eats any of them. Maybe he's protecting his territory, but he never attacks any of the humans, and it looks like he's got a major infestation problem. And weapons clearly hurt him. We're told he wants to bring balance.
He's here to restore balance. A power to restore balance.
Whatever that means.
You refer to the prophecy of the one who will bring balance to the Force.
That's not a Godzilla creature. No way Godzilla has that many ribs. And the spine's backwards. And what about these things? Their design is generic, but the sound is great. Their life cycle is contradicted throughout the film. At first they're said to be parasites that lay eggs in other creatures.
Killed by these.
Parasitic spores.
But then they make a nest for their eggs instead.
If the Mutos have spawned, they'll be building a nest.
They mature inside cocoons, yet the small eggs clearly show they're the same shape as the fully grown adults. That's not how it usually works. The female is clearly upset when the nest is destroyed, yet creatures that give birth to lots of young don't have parental instincts, so it shouldn't be sad. People don't seem scared. Everyone runs for their life in an orderly fashion. Look at that terror on her face. You never see the effect this has on people. You see broken buildings and things, but it's just stuff. Everyone is still at work, business as usual. And no one dies, at least not on screen. Even cuts away when a main character dies.
We're losing him. Joe, can you hear me? He's going at AFib. Give me another.
No one suffers. Compare this to the original Godzilla, where children are dying from radiation poisoning. Or where this woman tries to comfort her children as they die. I suppose there's always the scene where his dad dies. And now for the emotional reaction to his father's death. The military is so blind and dumb it hurts. Like with these three helicopter pilots that are flying around the mountain but can't see the monster.
That glows in the dark.
Or this idiot just flies straight into the Muto. This helicopter didn't spot the huge hole in the mountain before these soldiers had time to run all that way. The military say they've got no extraction plan.
We have no extraction plan.
What do you call that? At Honolulu, the soldiers say the creature has been seen 2 knots away.
2 knots due east of your position.
But knots aren't distance, they're speed. That's like saying we saw the Muto 2 jogging paces away. The bomb has a simultaneous key turn lock for security, yet the locks are so close together one person could turn both locks at the same time. I'm aware this sounds like a very negative review, and the film does have a lot of problems, but the good parts are almost mind-blowing. Just look at how amazing this is.
I'm a firing my leader!